compounds test on disease model animal, and suppose diabetic animal, if you test it and for a diabetic drug, that will if the diabetic is decreased, that means that compound will be shortlisted. Now we have to find it out. They call it a hit molecule. You have to find it out how this molecule is decreasing the diabetic disease, diabetic condition. So that they have to find a mechanism of action. They have to find a actual target is where it is binding. So very, very big process is still remain before comes to the clinical trial. So they have to screen all the proteins where it is binding. And this is also called as a target phishing and reverse docking in computational world. Here also you can use artificial intelligence and machine learning automatic fashion. This we have developed it, and I will explain it in a case study. Now we'll go to the drug discovery process. Drug discovery pipeline, if you see that there is the here it will take R&D drug discovery, then this before preclinical, everything is around 7 years you will work and you will select some compounds and you go to the clinical trial. This is not really work like this because sometimes you will be failed in R&D or preclinical, so your compound will be stopped, or you have to come back and check again. Is there any different compound is working or not? Then only few compounds will enter to the clinical trial. It is not passing the clinical trial. It is entered to the clinical trial only few compounds. So this is the costly. And spending so many years of the so many scientists working on these compounds, compound generation. And if it goes to the in deep R&D process, there will be a target identification, there is a compound screening, there is a lead identification. And then after finding the lead, there is a in vitro studies, in vivo studies, and some standard process will be there for preclinical studies, and also standard process for R&D studies. Suppose if you want to find a lead compound, you have to have some kind of activity with particular protein. That protein has a role in particular disease. This kind of role you will get it. So this every process, it has a very complex, and the multiple teams are involved. Suppose if you goes to the target identification time, there will be analytical chemistry, there will be animal health, there will be understanding the clinical research people will be there, biomedical people. So the hundreds of teams working together and find that particular region. So the data is very broad, and finding this kind of data, it is very difficult. Means connecting the every dot in this data is huge. So in human mind, we cannot think about this data, understand alone. So better use the AI algorithms to understand the patterns in the data. Because there is analytical chemistry, find that this drug is effective, and there is a chemist guy build a different molecule and say that is better than that one. And like this, there will be a medicinal chemist, there is a drug designer, and there is a PKPD studies, the safety analysis. Lots of process is going on. So we have to find a, we cannot really take the big problem to the AI. If you see here, you can see that there is a multiple problems here. One is the cost. Drug discovery process is a very costly affair. And there is a time consuming. If you see here, duration of that I am pre R&D, it is 4.5 years, and preclinical one year. And this and the number of experiments also very high. And if you see the probability of failure, it is very high. It's 49% is failure in R&D studies. And very costly when it is a failure in phase two, it's a 56% because of it not impacted the disease. So this failure also we have to reduce. So we cannot really gather the data for this big problem. So we have to slice the problem and make the mission to digest all the data in particular fashion. It's very important task for drug discovery process. Here there is a sections are divided into the based into the parts based on the R&D R&D drug discovery process. Suppose the target selection. In target selection, how they will select the target based on the understanding of the molecular bias of the disease, molecular disease. Understanding how this disease occurring. And another one is the NGS studies, and there is a disease and drug association. There is a pathway which is affecting this disease, and in that pathway there is a particular proteins are involved, so we can target that proteins. And there is a biomarkers when this disease, suppose a diabetic, there is a glucose reductions are happening. So this kind of studies we can see that in target selection process. So every problem you have to build a particular AI model to solve the bigger problem of drug discovery. And if you see that lead discovery is a compound particular lead finding out. There is a protein structure you have to identify. There is a virtual screening you have to do, high thought screening you have to do, and the fragment-based screening, and there is a development of SMADR. So here, everywhere, we can apply the AI, but it is particularly focusing on particular problem. You have to build a model, you have to collect the data, you have to make the models related to the problem. And all together, you can combine it also. If it goes to the medicinal chemistry, there is a chemical synthesis, and there is a structural activity relationship, and lead optimization will come. And vitro, in vitro studies, vivo studies, and clinical trial. There is a problems everywhere, every studies, small problems are mentioned, and the data collective data have to be gathered. So now, every problem we have to collect the data and generate the model and study it experimentally. And if it is coming good, it's okay. If not coming, we have to rebuild the model, increase the data, increase the feature selection, do this process automatic fashion so that you are building an AI platform related to the drug discovery. Small problems also we have to build. Suppose if you are looking for ADMET properties or selectivity, how you will find a selectivity for kinase? You have to check all kinase protein molecules. This compound is binding or not. So this data, if it is a protein or previously this protein or kinase one is have active compounds, some inactive compounds. Now you build a model for particular kinase. Now you give that compound and say that this kinase will bind to this compound or not. That particular question, it will give the answer, it will bind or not bind. Or if it is bind, what is the activity value? Those things we can build a model and develop it continuously, different models, and combine it in as a AI application. If it goes to the big pharma, there is really, they don't have time to make this huge number of models. So what they did is a collaborative way. They collaborate with different AI startups and build models and share the data between those two and build the models. It's based on their data. They Takeda. They build their models using for cancer research for a small molecule therapy. They build the models. This molecule will work in cancer. So like this, they will big pharmas all collaborate with AI startups, and AI startups will build the models and deploy in. For their purpose. That is the way people do at present. If it goes to the all the startups, which is the building AI applications for drug discovery, they also will not work entire pipeline of drug discovery. They will work in small problems like atom-wise screening the small molecule with the particular proteins. So this are particular disease oriented. Suppose atom wise working with malaria with Merck. So they build malaria related targets in this using deep learning. And if you give any compound, they will tell you that it will work for malaria or not. Based on the different target will be there. And the targets are related to the malaria. So like this, it will work. Every AI startup you can see here, there is a Numerate, there is a InSilico. Everyone has a different indications. And if they have multiple indications, there will be a small division of the complex. So you can get that information when we go further. So I like to explain a few more startups are in deep what they're doing, because we can understand what the AI company is doing in drug discovery process. Here Precision Life. These Precision Lives based on the data which is gives the genomic data and phenotypic data. These all startups will use for target selection for particular disease. So for because of time, I'm just going fast. If you have any more details about this startup, you can go. Given the links in reference. And atom-wise, you know, it is predicted the drug candidates and based on the neural network. And also it will give you the synthetic steps of that molecule, how to build. And Numerate will analyze the public domain data and will give you that what drugs it belongs to which disease related. Suppose oncology related, there is a particular type of the drugs is related to the cancer, it will work very nicely. Part of the compound, it will work nice in oncology related fragment base. And Cyclica will explain about the mechanism of action based on the reverse docking. It is predicting the pharmacokinetic or polypharmacology, multiple targets, if selectivity, those kind of things, which if you give the compound, it will select different targets and finalize that this compound will bind multiple targets. Which targets they bind, it will tell you. And e-therapeutics is based on the cellular network, and it will give you about the related mechanism of action, how it is the curing that disease, which is the related pathway is occurring based on the drug interaction and protein-protein interaction. And in silico medicine, working especially and aging related disease, and it will build a drug molecule, a new drug molecule, and test aging related disease. It is one of the top a drug discovery field. And this is also is based on the target and disease related to XR. It is one of the big in disease biology. And this is a German company which is gives the understand that all bio test related understand the articles published in publication and credit the biomarkers, which biomarkers is suitable for particular disease. So there are also in clinical trial, which is the biomarker identification. And I like to give examples of my own where I worked in Accelera. This is the data we have collected for drug repurposing. Different public domain data collecting in different data marts, like compound related data, gene expression related data, pathway related data. All the data concluded in one integrated database and combined with the internal data, proprietary data like GoSTAR and the structural activity, like a biomarker database, so that we can build an application based on this data. Because here, what is the problem is that integration of the data. Suppose one data has the protein to disease. Another database has the protein to drug molecule interaction activity related data. You have to combine those data and feed it into the machine learning is very important part. And that integration of the data have to be automatic fashion. Otherwise, it will be confusing for machine learning and also for us. And after building the databases, you can build algorithms based on that data, like literature mining, adverse event prediction, and protein-protein interaction, and pathway finding, gene expression data analysis, like this. And finally, you will get a conclusion that suppose if you give the one drug molecule, it is this drug molecule is approved for diabetic. Is it work for cancer disease or not? You want to know that information. It will be automatically will be given that, and also it will give you the clear cut where it is published, how it is affecting that cancer killing the cancer cells. This kind of information also will be provided based on the data. And we build an AI application in Jubilant. This is the one as the target identification, based on the target identification plus a structural activity prediction. And you can see there is a multiple problems will be solved automatically, saying that is the selectivity issues, and ADMAT is toxicity will be there or not. Blood barrier, it is crossing the blood barrier or not. This kind of work can be done using this platform. And this platform is, we have tested in 2017, I think. We based on our study, case study, we given a number of cancer drugs. And we selected one disease like a diabetic. Then it checking that these cancer drugs will work on diabetic or not. It will cure the diabetic or not. We tested, we collected the data for particularly diabetic targets related data. And we find that if you give that drug molecule, we build models for every target. And we analyze the target related data. And see that where these cancer drugs are binding in this particular diabetic targets and how it is affecting the overall pathway. that's things we analyze it and will give you automatically what is the top target is binding all the cancer drugs. So this study already published in recently in Novartis recent publication. It is very related to our topic, so I like to mention this study. This given this all the databases, lab means structural activity relation, and the literature mining based on the disease and target and compound related information given to that integrated database, and build a models, QSR models, and predict that model and do experimental validation and update the models. Like this, the process will work on it. So after for case study, we given this cancer drug molecule, all cancer drug molecules, and checking that diabetic, all the diabetic related targets, which compound will bind the diabetic related targets. We find the top six compounds which is the binding diabetic targets. Six compound, all out of 10, it is all are steroids. You when this comes to the our mind, how the steroids affecting the diabetic. We know that steroids will affect on the ER stress pathway, so that maybe it is affecting the related to the stress pathway. So we checked it, this steroids really controlling the glucose. It is, every scientist know that this will affect on diabetic. Before running this algorithm, we really don't know, because cancer drugs working for the diabetic, it is very rare. Nobody will test it, because the cancer drug a little bit toxic to the cells, so that we don't want to check in diabetic like related condition. But we want to analyze this kind of data, which is never published. But we find it this kind of steroids really working on glucose control. So in machine learning, it will really predicting different than the what humans will analyze based on the data. So not only that, there is every compound, every target, multiple active compounds, multiple inactive compounds will be there. We build a model and say if a new compound comes, it will be an active compound or inactive compound, we can say. And we can build automatically based on the fragments, and we can get the patent related to the new molecule fragment based drug discovery also. We can use the AI and ML related applications. In total summary, I like to give that systems that analyze and find the patterns in the data is the form of AI and ML application. And just like humans learn from the experience, and computers learn from the data. And you know it, narrow AI, it is a very limited task. Hello.
Yes, Dr. Raghu.
Yeah, we are
getting
your voice, sir.
Yeah, predictive model is one of the model we can generate using AI and ML. And every model building time, there will be a number of predictors. That means a number of data will be there that you have to find it out which is the related to the your model. And based on that model, some statistical rules will be applied in machine learning and build the models. After building the models, you have to analyze that data and revise that model and update it is very important. And the model selection, which model you use, it is depending on your data. It will be a simpler linear equation, linear regression, or complex neural network like a deep learning. It is depending on your data. And drug discovery process will take a long time to approve the drug. If you want to reduce the R&D cost and reduce the time, it will be build a different models for every team. and AI/ML approaches will be suitable for drug discovery, but it have to be built a multiple models for one complex problem. Integrating the multiple data and converting into the machine readable format is the big task in model building or AI in drug discovery. Collecting that data is very important, which is related to the problem. And the AI/ML approaches ready to apply means many people did biological activity of the new compound, and people find it out what protein family is affecting and pathways is affecting those things. And many toxicology studies, genome toxic profiles are built using AI/ML. And we also developed integrated target discovery applications and using AI/ML and docking process, which is in silico drug discovery. And this combination of AI/ML and docking technology will be very good, suitable for this target profile of the compound. And finally, we know that every big pharma has very big data, but is not well organized. And you can see here, CTO of Numerate mentioned it. Data is available, but it's not in clean form. So cleaning that data is take huge task. And really, the AI cannot be applied, but the success stories not there at present because it is not real simple process, simple model like finding the image recognition or cat and dog. It is not that simple. It is very complex. So you have to build a multiple model and test different. But there is a really success stories how machine learning predicting the organic reactions. There is applied in deep learning to understand the disease biology. There is a process, lots of process working on it. So in future, it will be a good to work with this because there is AutoML came now. So automatically you can select the machine learning algorithm, which is suitable for your data. There is hyperparameter tuning is coming so that you can check that automatically, which parameter is suitable, how many neurals layers of the neural network will work for your data. Those things will be automatically analyzed. This all is a take-home message. And if you have any question, you can send them a chat or you can inform me.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Santosh, it's over to you now. Yes.
So I request participants, if you really put it into the box.
In the meantime, shall I ask one question?
Yeah, please. So I collect the questions from YouTube.
Yeah,
there are about 100 participants on the YouTube also.
Yeah, please. And in the meantime, I'll just
please continue the question.
Yeah, wonderful presentation, Dr. Buri. That was very informative. I just wanted to know, nowadays, you know what's happening outside about this COVID-19 and very little information and data is available about it. So do you think AI technologies can help us bring the vaccine or the drugs quicker or more effectively? Do you see any role for it? Because there is very little data available on COVID-19.
There is a different synonym here. One is the controlling, suppose COVID-19 problem is the biggest one, means there is a complex problem is there, but they are finding the relation between the disease to disease.
Okay.
Suppose this is related to the TB or related to the malaria. So it will work like that. So it will be people are connecting the dot, how the symptoms of the COVID-19, what is the symptoms of the other disease.
Okay,
so you, it is easy to connect the dots, then applying the machine learning, it will really help. But you have to give the specific data, gathering that related data. Suppose how people are thinking that COVID-19 symptoms is this. To find it, symptom-wise analysis. Lots of people are doing. Suppose if you go to the one of the case studies mentioned in startups, all the startups there will be having a COVID-19 session.
Yeah, so they're just building up, and eventually it will be useful. But just as a follow-up, more than 50% of the audience are students here, and by this unprecedented rush, we can already anticipate that most of them are interested in learning a thing about artificial intelligence. So what would be your advice to all those students who have, and also to the young faculties who have interest in this AI technologies? What would be your advice to them?
My request is simple, is that before want to apply AI and ML, you understand what problem you want to solve.
Okay.
Clearly understand what problem you want to solve. Then try to get the data. Then it's automatic you are building a AI ML application.
Yeah.
But clarity, getting the problem, what you want to solve, is very, very important.
Sure.
Sir?
Yeah.
Buri sir?
Yeah.
This is Dr. Santosh. And there are a few questions on YouTube.
Okay.
The first question I would like to share from Amrita Honkeri.
Okay.
What she asked, how AI can help in the management of COVID-19 other than repurposing the drug?
Okay, we can predict that where is the spreading. I have seen when it is going to over the COVID-19 situation, lockdown situation. That is also, we can predict it, where we can stop it. Means spreading the COVID-19 also is a good to apply AI and ML. And finding the symptoms, it is also very important. Means some people don't know that they got COVID-19. But if you simple chatbot, if you send it to them and asking what is the symptoms you have, based on that analysis, you can say that you got COVID-19. Those like that simple application will be very helpful.
Okay.
And finding
there is another question.
Yeah.
Yep. If you not finished, you please continue.
Yeah. If you diagnose that COVID-19, there is X-rays also. They're doing it. This is an image analysis technique, which is belongs to AI. And it will also really, before testing your samples, they can say that you got a COVID-19.
Okay. Then there is another question by Lata Prasad. How can we use AI in academic research? And with the same question, she also asked whether any free software available that can be used in the academia.
Okay. Yeah, lots of free softwares available, especially Python oriented. It's a huge area. And even Google also released TensorFlow, like that AI ML applications, free of cost. Lots of applications are there without any cost. But you have to have some kind of knowledge how to use it.
It means language is necessary.
Not language. It is suppose you want to learn, you want to apply the deep learning algorithm for particular problem, and you have every data. It is a simple like orange. There is a application. You have to download it and click button. You can do it. Or there is a Vika software, you can download it and open your Excel sheet and you can build a models.
Okay.
but you have to understand that this data is related to the your problem. That's all.
Sir, another question from one of the student. He is a first year MPharm student, and he wanted to know how can AI technology can be used to prepare research project. Is any industry help students to get into these kind of research project?
Yeah, there is big research is going on is natural language processing or natural language understanding, NLP, NLU area. This area will this well area will help you that suppose if you are giving a 10 articles to read that algorithm and to say that give me summary of short summary of that, and we are also building like application try to understand the patent, what is the claims are there, and if you give multiple patent will give you what is the claim understanding. Those things are really understanding the language written in these articles and rewrite that program to the what we need it. Suppose if I give a 10 patent and give me what really this patent related, which company made it and how they made it, what is the claims, when it is going to be end. In short summary, give me that specifications of the claims. This all you can make the simple landscape of the patent. And there is a lots of applications also already built on this patent landscaping. And people are working very hard on natural language understanding. So this can be done. But I don't think research-oriented project, because the project is the idea. Idea cannot be derived from the particularly data.
I see. Sir, there are a few questions in the Zoom also. Swarup Lahoti wanted to ask, how can we use AI in formulation and development? Oh. Is there any way?
Yeah. I have developed one formulation application. This is called a recommendation engine, which is, suppose if you want to develop a particular API, what are the excipients suitable for this particular API? If I do this API, if I build a product based on this API using these excipients, my stability of the product, the drug product, will increase or not? Things we can apply in particular manner in formulation, and we can build a model. There is a development is going. It's already started. Using people are using in that Redis. So there's lots of things we can do in formulation development.
Fine. So I think we are enough with the questions. If at all there will be questions, we'll take a few more questions, like one or two. There is a question. What is driving today's progress in AI? What is driving progress in today's AI?
Maybe the driving force, the motivation.
Driving force in AI, it is anywhere you can apply.
Okay.
Means it is a simple that you can apply. Suppose I want to make a toy for my kid.
Okay.
You can do it. You can build an application that if you make one toy car, your daughter will never touch it. When they touch it, it goes before she touching. Means you have to utilize that sensors and applications and build it using your idea. So anywhere it can be applied AI application. So that simple means you need to have an idea how to apply,
yep.
where the data is there, how to apply.
Santosh, now I think we close the question session.
Sir, can I ask the last question?
Yeah, please, please, sir.
Raghu sir, maybe this is the last question I want to ask. I saw in your summary slides that you said that AI can make this drug discovery quicker, cheaper, and more effective. But then again, you also mentioned that there are not any big examples or good examples to say. So, when will we get the first drug which can be claimed as the AI, which was totally AI developed one?
Yeah, you know it. Even you build a very, very good AI algorithms or AI platform, but validation have to be done by experiments.
Okay.
But we can be a support team for the discovery process, and to get that exactly. Suppose if you are running 10 clinical trial compounds. In place of 10, you can run 5 compounds.
Okay, so I think maybe another 2 or 3 years it will take time before it gets any good results, or we start seeing drugs coming out of this AI process.
Yes, it will reduce the complexity in drug discovery process. Indeed, it will reduce the time, and it will reduce the experimental cost.
Yeah.
So that it will process will be speed up.
So that means there's a huge potential for it, and the youngsters have lots of things to do there.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Sir.
Yeah. Just a minute, sir. There are I think 9-10 question on YouTube in the same line.
Okay.
Yeah. And all maybe from the student side, I think, because the question seems like it is asked by student. Can you suggest any courses that can be done after BE Pharm or M Pharm?
Okay.
So as we can get easy entry in the industry.
Before there is a lots of courses are there. People are studying. But for my personal opinion, doing the courses is not going to help you. Okay. Do practice. If you want to really build a models or you want to use it, take one real time example. Try to build a data, try to build a model, try to analyze that. Then you will learn a lot. Then the making a courses in online.
Yeah.
Practice is very, 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 very crucial for this model building and understanding the models.
Means altogether for AI, we need to first have a clear cut idea about the problem, and we need to generate a large amount of data about it.
Yes, and go specifically for particular problem, try to build a model and try to see that why it is a different algorithms are behaving differently. What is the max behind it? How it is behaving differently? What is this? How we are selecting this feature is very important. So this kind of analysis will teach you a lot than the going to tutorials.
So I think we stop here for the questions. Still there are questions are coming, but we're not going to take any more questions now. So now I request Anil sir. Hello. Anil sir, are you there in the room? Hello.
Hello Anil sir.
I think he is not here.
Hello.
But I think Ravi. Yeah, Anil sir is here. Yep, sir.
Yes, Dr. Santosh.
Yeah, we done with the question session, sir. So now you please propose a vote of thanks with Ravi Kiran, sir.
Sir, some problem from my side as far as connectivity is concerned.
Okay.
You please.
So I think Ravi Kiran sir is here. Yeah, he is here. Ravi Kiran sir, please. I request you to propose the vote of thanks.
Hi, Dr. Santosh and Dr. Anil and Dr. Raghu. Glad to meet you over this, the virtual conversation.
Thank you.
Glad to have you all here. And it's really wonderful to connect with you. And thank you so much for being part of this initiative. And I think when we really looked at the overall, the macro spectrum of the topic, I think gives me a lot of joy in sharing. Till yesterday, that the entire industry is really looking at more on the IT, ITES industries. But thanks to COVID, that there is a paradigm shift in thought process, that not just that the conventional IT is going to be anymore. I think the fundamental courses like healthcare is going to be back on track. I think that gives me a lot of joy in sharing, and I think this is an apt time that you are here. And also gives me that the healthcare industry is also evolving rapidly with the large volumes of data. I think a couple of years back, it is more on how the patient is, but it is not about the patient now. It is the record of the patient is also equally becoming a viable source of information in curing the disease in the long run. Yeah. I think what you are really articulated, especially in the new AI models, can really help the radiologist distinguishing the COVID between the non-COVID pneumonias and all that, and reading the chest CT examinations. And also happened to see some of these, when Dr. Anil Peters suggested me to join the webinar, and also started reading some of this, and it's really interesting to know there are a lot of AI tools are also being predicted on the social distancing. That is something very, very interesting to know. And of course, your area of interest, especially on the cancer that you have really mentioned, I think seems to be a very, very a unique one. And I think time has come that I think early adopters of AI is going to healthcare space are reaping the benefits in terms of the patient care, adding their bottom line results, and everyone is noticing that the scale, how it is really progressing. And I think companies are also started using for the number of scenarios, including what you have mentioned is the managing the claims, detecting the fraud, improving the clinical workflows, predicting the hospitals acquired infections. I think that's something which is very on a positive note. And open source enterprises, open source and enterprise AI platforms are really empowering the leading the healthcare companies to deliver very good solutions in AI platform, and that's going to be the change in the industry. And thank you so much, Dr. Raghu. Happy to have you, and more importantly, that your eye for the details and addressing the Q&A very, very eloquently is really appreciable. And thanks to all the participants being part of this initiative, and our apologies. I think we also in this COVID situation, we are also doing a lot of experiments, moving from one platform to the other, how each platform is really behaving. I think we need to run with the time, and thanks for your patience and understanding moving from a YouTube platform to a Zoom, and that's really, really great. And also happy to note some of our participants are at the naturally enjoying the farmhouses, backyard and all that. I think that shows the learning is going to be a very natural phenomenon now. Yeah. So thanks to everyone.
Thank you, Ravi sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, and Dr. Anil, Dr. Santosh, Dr. Kapil, everybody are fabulously managed it. And Dr. Raghu, we continue to have you here. We seek your more guidance in days to come. Okay, not just one webinar, but more frequent visits to the campus once the situation prevails, and also more interest in the students' well-being in the entire process.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Well, sir, I have to express my thanks to all the YouTube viewers, because we got little bit delay on the YouTube, so extremely sorry for that, but you people beared with us. Thank you very much for the patience, and I think this session is over here.
Thank you everyone. Have a nice evening.
Thank you, Sandra.
Thank you, Raghu sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, Raghu sir.